Hey everybody, today I am going to be reviewing a short film, and that short film is directed by David Lynch. It is entitled, What Did Jack Do? It's not drawing much attention to itself, and I honestly would have had no idea about it had it not been for the cinephiles on Twitter. It's a word of mouth thing, I guess, because when I went to Netflix to watch it, it wasn't even on the homepage. Like, it wasn't even advertised as a like David Lynch short film or anything. It was something I kind of had to seek out. And it just didn't make sense to me, but then I thought, well, you know, it's David Lynch. When does he ever make sense? He hasn't made a feature-length film since Inland Empire, which was in 2006. That's almost 15 years ago. Of course, he's done other creative things, other creative endeavors he's pursued, such as he's gotten into music and painting. And I see all kinds of weird stuff. I remember one time I was blazed out of my mind, and it was probably like 4 in the morning or something, and it was like raining, and I come across this video of David Lynch cooking quinoa. That was a very surreal experience watching that film. Finally, he starts digging into much more dense projects like he used to when he decided to do season 3 of Twin Peaks back in 2017. So that made me think that maybe he is starting to get back more into film, and you know, seeing this come out really tickled my curiosity as a huge Lynch fan, naturally. It also got me wondering, is this like the tip of the iceberg to more things like this coming? Maybe even more ambitious projects in the future? Or is this just something he did because he felt like it. It could honestly be either one. It's always hard to say. He's a very cryptic individual. He never explains his intent or his creative process or anything like that, which I love. And this short film is classic Lynch, just in terms of concept. He's doing what he always does, and you know, I've mentioned it many times and lots of David Lynch reviews I've done in the past, but what is his style and his concepts are typically taking all of these old tropes from classic Hollywood and then searching for a sort of glitchy, trippy, kind of psycho sexual center. The dark underbelly beneath that glamorized facade that we all know. And he's doing it in this instance. It's a very low budget, very simple setup and premise from the first frame. And I think anyone who is a Lynch fan would think, this must be like an homage to Eraserhead or something of that nature. It is black and white. You see a monkey named Jack sitting at a table on a train. There are deliberate scratches and things on the film to make it look purposely really old, very nostalgic. And then enters Lynch. He stars in the short as well. And he is sitting across from the monkey with his cigarette, and he begins interrogating him. He's a sort of detective. And I thought to myself, oh, okay. So yeah, we are taking a lot of these old Hollywood tropes, because this setup is very similar to the opening scene, of course, in Hitchcock's Strangers on a Train. And as they begin talking, the dialogue is absolutely fascinating, extremely peculiar. And like I said before, taking those tropes, all of those Hitchcockian tropes, film noir, he's really subverting it. And Lynch, of course, being in the film, it's like, you know, he likes to make cameos a lot in his work. And when he does that, it's like he's mocking acting and mocking old Hollywood. And he's doing so with the dialogue here, because always his delivery is just really loud, and it's always at this volume. It's meant to be bad. So him being like this dark detective protagonist is inherently funny. Because normally you have that kind of gruff character who's always like, oh, that dame, I can't get her out of my mind. I couldn't trust her as far as I could throw her. Typical dialogue from noir films of the 1940s. And so it already has that parody effect in and of itself. But as it goes, the dialogue becomes more and more interesting. It feels like fractured bits of dialogue from old films, and they are glitching and twisting into something new and warped. It's like a garbled version, lingering in the unconscious mind of old Hollywood, but it's just not concrete, and it never was. It is a fever dream of sorts, like a lot of Lynch films, taking that dream logic, pulling from the psyche where a lot of these tropes originated from. At some point in time, from someone's mind or multiple people, and Lynch, as he does in Mulholland Drive and in Lost Highway, Twin Peaks, Blue Velvet, etc., he's searching for those parts of the mind that are, you know, maybe neglected. Because often the things that we neglect or we're too afraid to push for when we're thinking, when we're creative or expressive, whatever, that's where things start to get interesting. And that's what he's interested in. He's interested in the parts of us that are the most bizarre, the most surreal, the most unpredictable and vulnerable, because that's where the breakthrough really occurs, the true creativity anyway. In this short film, even though it is so simple, it seems to have all of that just in this conversation between Lynch and Jack the monkey. I had to watch it twice because there's a lot in that dialogue, more than you might think when you first watch it. Some of it does very well, could be just gibberish, completely random, meaningless stuff, like, you know, sometimes in dreams you have meaningless things occur. But I think some of it is up to interpretation a lot more. And in the scene, mainly, we have the detective trying to interrogate the monkey who has been accused of murder. And the conversation just touch on vulnerability and that childlike expression that's peeling away just little by little. There are lines like, there is no Santa Claus, or there's a line by Jack where he says, the wonder was in my heart, but you wouldn't understand something like that. This is fascinating dialogue because it seems to loop around and around and around with no fixed structure, but there is a definite structure. It's just very cleverly disguised. It feels so much like a dream. It's uncanny. As soon as something concrete starts to materialize, it instantly seems to dissolve before you can grasp it. And because of that very abstract nature of everything, you, when you're watching it, you kind of lose time yourself. You kind of, you get lost in the experience of watching the film. Humor, of course, is also a big staple of David Lynch. Very quirky humor that is unlike anybody else. And it's often in the way that Lynch is observing humans and human behavior. And here it's through a lot of animal symbolism, but here we have many animal puns, more than you could possibly think of. Things like, you know, I know why the chicken crossed the road, and the elephant in the room, etc., etc. But then, like I said before, there is more, I think, of introspection amidst all of the humor and the randomness when Jack says something like, you toss an animal up on the roof just to look at its face. There's certainly truth to that, just a mistreatment of animals for entertainment, the way that humans interact with animals. There's always something kind of strange about that, I always thought, but there's a... That's an interesting segue. That's where you're starting to feel more of the pathos in the story, and you start to feel maybe a sort of sympathy for the accused monkey and his broken heart for the love of a chicken. But that's where you start to see more of the pain and the darkness, and even maybe like the sexual perversion, I guess you could say, that we're starting to get a grasp on. But more than that, because it is Lynch, you don't even have to take the film itself and the plot and the dialogue or any of it literally at all. Because when we're looking at the film, if we look at it in terms of dream logic, perhaps Lynch, the artist, the person creating the film, that's what he is. That's what he represents, the artist. And he's having a dream sort of conversation with himself, or an aspect of himself that is represented in the monkey. In dreams, it's common to, when you have a conversation with another person in the dream, that's often an aspect of yourself that you're trying to discover. Not always, but it's quite common. And it's also a common symbol of monkeys that represent a sort of mischief or wickedness. Maybe it's a sort of thing where he's discovering the little pieces of his own unconscious mind. And really the scenario in the conversation is more a psychological examination of one individual, just like Mulholland Drive. I know I've talked about what I feel the film is about for myself, and I often argue there is no Rita, there is no Betty, there's no Camilla, any of that. It's all just one human being exploring themselves through all of these psychological facets. I also say that because the monkey, when he talks, there's a mouth superimposed over it, like the old Conan Late Show. He's credited as himself, but the voice of the monkey, it's like very loud, and but it's very distorted, so it's kind of hard to figure out who it is, but I mean, it's gotta be Lynch. I'm almost positive it is, and that does add another layer to things. He is talking to himself in a sense, or talking to the monkey who sort of represents an aspect of himself. Now, if you ask him, I'm sure he would say, well, I did the voice because it was cheaper. But I say, as a viewer, that maybe that whole aspect of him being the voice and all of that just adds another layer of possibility for me. In the end, I kind of feel torn. You know, I don't want the monkey necessarily to get caught because there is that pathos there. But, you know, you also have to see justice being served as well. And that's kind of what the film is saying ultimately, I think. It's just everyone has their reasons and the things about them that are so painfully human, yet justice in the social system must be served, especially when that deep impulsive anger is aroused within us and it becomes violent, and all coming from a place of love in the heart. And that's the sad, tragic part of human nature. And that's essentially what I think Blue Velvet examines in a certain way, what Twin Peaks examines, and many more works that he's done. I enjoyed the film. I did. I think it was simple and obscure enough to where I'm not taking it that seriously, but yet there's enough here for me to really ponder and contemplate for a while in a very fun sort of way. And it's an interesting psychological study through surrealism, classic David Lynch. I really hope he makes more stuff, and I hope that this this is maybe an introduction back into more material that we're going to see from him. In the last couple of years, especially with Twin Peaks and all of that, gave me hope for him as well, that he'll start digging more into that kind of work. But if you're going to watch this movie, may I recommend watching it the same way that I saw the him cooking quinoa, that video. Middle of the night, you know, best way. And that is my review. Thank you all for listening. All my social media information is below. You can watch more videos here, and you can subscribe if you'd like. Catch you next time.